Well, I'm excited to be here. I just love being with people who want to learn, and I'm just delighted to have you here. I just have a tradition in my classroom that I always start with a song. So I put the words up here, so if you don't know, you can look up here so you can sing along with me. When pioneers moved to the West with courage strong, they met the test. They pushed their hand carts all day long, and as they pushed, they sang this song. For some must push and some must pull as we go marching up the hill. So merrily on our way we go until we reach the valley, oh. Thank you. Music is just a powerful way to bring children together, to focus. And there are so many gospel principles and science principles that can be taught through songs. Can anybody find a principle of science that you could talk about with that song?
Push and pull.
Absolutely. Yeah, when you teach physics, you can talk about pushing and pulling. And we'll talk about other songs as we go. But it's an interesting way to add some interest to your lessons. You know, it's funny. If you put me in front of 500 kindergartners, I would not be nervous, but adults make me uncomfortable. So if I'm a little stuttery, I'll get over it eventually. My goal today is to help you feel confident and excited about your ability to teach science. We all have a variety of backgrounds. My story is, yes, I have been an elementary teacher for, this is my 31st year. But in the public schools, I didn't teach a whole lot of science. I haven't had any science training. I came here and started teaching kindergarten, and it was about October of my second year that I got called into the principal's office, which is always a nerve-wracking experience, even as an adult. And I was told, we really want you to stay on the bus, but we want you to change seats. Okay? We want you to teach science. And I'm sure it was deer in the headlight, because I thought, why would you want me to teach science? I have no background in science. I don't have a clue what I would teach. But I trusted and said, okay. And the next week, I started teaching science. And every night, it was reading so that I would know at least this much more than they did about what I was teaching. But what happened is, over the course of the next 2 years, as I started putting this science program together, as I gained such an appreciation for our Father in Heaven and His creations and how incredibly orderly He is and how it is manifested repeatedly through all branches of science. I became a very passionate learner, and I know that that can happen for you too, that you don't have to know science. You just have to want to be able to learn and to love Heavenly Father and His creations. So I just want to get an idea from you. What kind of background do you have in science, or what's your comfort level, or are you all saying, I don't want to teach science, or where are you at? I'm just going to go around and ask everybody.
I took some science in college and advanced science in high school, but it's been a lot of years.
Okay.
Okay.
Oh, you're ahead of me. Janelle?
I think the closest thing I have is studying sound editing. So.
Oh, interesting.
That's the closest I can get.
Okay.
Right.
I think a lot of us are in that boat.
Yeah, I had very little science in college.
I understand. Yes.
I'm a dentist and got a minor in chemistry. And I have some hobbies that work for me to do some science.
Oh.
Aquaponics and stuff like that.
I have an aquaponics set up in my classroom. It's cool. Well, great. Then you're a good resource in your family. But you can always learn more. Yes.
I taught for a few years too in school. I was an elementary teacher, but science was the subject at school that I hated and didn't do well in, and I don't want to transfer that to my kids. So I'm trying to figure out how to do the opposite.
Right.
Science is awesome, and you'll love it, not like mom. Because I know it's cool. I just never got it, and so I dreaded it even in college. So I don't want to do that for my kids.
Great, great. How about you?
I just took science at school. And my daughter loves science, so I try to learn more about it to keep her
Good, good. Yes. That's good. That's more than I had. Yes.
I enjoy science too, but I get nervous when my kids want to focus on science, like the girl in your classroom, and they love it. But for some reason, I get nervous about teaching. I love it.
Because if we don't understand it, it's really intimidating. Absolutely. Yes. Okay. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I have an online dissection, do you like? Yeah. All right, Jenny, how about you?
I do just have a lot of questions.
Mm-hmm.
And so my son has just been like, I wonder why those people are angry. Like, they're not saying green, well, let's research it, and then we just work together.
Excellent. And that's the basics, is if you have questions and you can be brave enough to say, I don't know, but we'll find out. That is the key to teaching science. It is okay to say, I don't know. And you have to get over that really early, and then life becomes fun. My goal today is just to help you find a few resources and tools and ideas that you can use to make teaching science in your homes fun. So in the next 50 minutes, I want you to understand that there are just some basic things that you can do to make science great. The basic goals for me, why are we not clicking? There we go, is to help ourselves and our children understand the workings of the universe and everything that's in the universe. That doesn't mean you have to know and understand it, but it means we need to know where we can look to find out information from somebody who does understand it. To help ourselves and our children see, think, and feel differently because of what we learn. I do not look at anything in the same way since I have started teaching science. I don't listen to general conference the same way. I don't read the scriptures the same way because I now have this lens that changes how I see things. And I see God everywhere. And I see applications of science everywhere. And it's a wonderful mesh. I have no idea why people do not see this perfect connection between Heavenly Father and science. And finally, our goal in teaching science is to help everyone learn to see the Creator in all of His creations. So, crafting a lesson is sometimes intimidating. What do I do to make a lesson? So we're going to do something together today just to give you an idea how easy it is to put together a science lesson for home. To begin with, you have a paper plate. You have a toothpick. If you didn't get one, they're by the door. I'm now going to bring you a lima bean that has been soaking in water overnight. All right, help me out. Thank you. They're a tiny bit wet, but they're not too slimy. I'm sorry you have to do this on your lap, but we ran out of rooms with tables.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Look at these good manners. Thank you. You've got one. Did you get a paper plate as you came in? Tell you what, on the corner over there, there's a paper plate and a toothpick you'll need. And here is your bean.
Thank
and one
you.
For your friend. All right. I just need to get one for me. If you can do some kind of activity to start whatever it is you're teaching, you will automatically engage your children. Whether it's doing a song, doing some kind of activity to get everybody's attention is a great way to start. So I'm going to have you take your bean and just look at it a little bit. What are seeds for? What is their purpose?
To grow a plant.
So if you take your toothpick and in the back side, the curved side. You're going to just poke it in there gently and see if you can split that seed in half. It should just open up. And you can get a fingernail in there once you start splitting it so you can break it in half. And you'll end up with two halves. We call these halves cotyledons. They have a purpose that we'll talk about. Did anybody's skin fall off? All right, what is that? Any idea what that is? Yeah, it's called a seed coat. Every seed has a coat on it to protect it, just like we wear coats in the wintertime to protect us. And when the seed is still in the bag, its seed coat is very hard to protect that seed. But as soon as it gets wet, then it softens because it no longer is needed. The seed is ready to germinate. So you can just set that seed coat aside. These cotyledons provide food for a baby plant. Now, if you look carefully inside your bean, you should have some cute little, what would you call that? It's the baby plant. It's called an embryo. And what that is the baby plant ready to grow. And it takes food from these cotyledons to get it started. So when this seed is in the ground and it gets wet and the seed coat loosens, that little embryo will start to sprout. And first it will send out roots, and then it will send up a sprout that comes up through the soil. And once it gets out of the soil, then it will produce a leaf and start producing its own food. But Heavenly Father, in His wisdom, put in every seed a little packet of food to keep that baby going until it can create its own. You can set that under your chair or whatever you want, or play with it, but a little activity like that will get some discussion going. And we're going to talk more about that in a few minutes. Set mine up here. So, activities are a great way to start a lesson so that you have everybody's attention. Now, before you start the activity, I should have backed this up a little bit. You need to choose your topic and do a little bit of researching on it. And there are so many resources out there to help you with finding information. I brought a few of my favorite books up here, and I'm going to share with you a bunch of websites. In my handouts, there's a list of websites that I use quite often in crafting my lessons. And as I decide what I'm going to do, I had some guidelines. Also in your handout section, you'll have something that talks about the branches of science. It looks like this. And I just have gone through and told you about the three branches. There's physical science, earth science, and life science, and the different topics of science. So as you decide what you want to teach your children, there's a great list to give you a head start on where to look. I also tried to include some of the scientists who made great contributions in those fields, because I highly encourage you to do some biographical studies when you're studying science, because the people behind what we learn have so many good lessons in their lives to teach our children. As you teach your children about electricity, you want to talk to them about Michael Faraday. He was an extremely Christian man who overcame great obstacles to become who he became. And wonderful, wonderful stories in his life to teach your children character as well as about electricity. Now, as you're crafting your lesson, you've chosen a topic. All right, wrong one. Too many remotes. I can't emphasize enough how important it is to pray and ask Heavenly Father, what do you want me to teach your children about your creations? He will let you know what your children need to know. Because quite frankly, you can't teach everything on this sheet unless you want to take 10 years to do it. It just takes time, and so you can't teach everything. He will guide you, and He will guide you how to create your lesson. Determine an objective. What is it you want your children to know and to be able to do because of the experience that they have with you during that science lesson? A really important part of determining that objective is to plan then how you'll research together, to have an activity, plan some good questions that you can ask, and then make a gospel connection. That's one of the things I have loved most about teaching at American Heritage School is the blessing of being able to teach with the gospel. In almost everything we teach as parents about science, we can find a gospel application. And what's exciting is when you have a gospel application to it, then whenever they see that thing that you've been talking about out in the real world, it will remind them of the gospel application too. So think about that seed. What are some gospel applications? What's a gospel principle you could teach when you're teaching about seed germination?
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't remember if this was in one of the family school lessons or if it just came this way, but we talked about how a peach pit will only grow a peach tree, and kind of correlating that, and that we are created in God's image, that we can't become something else, and we didn't come from somewhere else because that's how we are too.
Excellent. All right, what's another one?
Just like the flower shelf, whatever cover thing it was, had to be softened to allow it grow. We have to soften, our hearts have to soften.
Oh, powerful. Thank you. Any other thoughts? What other gospel principle could we teach as we talk about germination?
Mm-hmm. He has a plan. And we're sitting here looking at these little tiny, like, leaves inside of the seed. And he has a plan. There's, it's food. There's food in there for the plant and everything. But
that little embryo has everything it needs.
He provides. He always provides what we need.
And isn't that just astonishing that even in seeds, Heavenly Father cared enough to design it to succeed and to thrive? So you have the idea. As you pick out what you're going to teach, try to find a gospel connection. And every time your child sees a seed after that, they will think about that gospel principle that you talk about, whether it's we are just an embryo of our Heavenly Father, or we need to have soft hearts in order to really grow. Those principles will be reminded every time they see a seed again. All right. This is one of my favorite parts, too, is to plan how you're going to record the things that you learned. We are a record-keeping people. It would have been great for Joseph Smith to have seen Heavenly Father in Jesus Christ, and he would have had just this wonderful experience. But imagine how life would be different if he had never recorded that. We depend on the scriptures, which are people recording their experiences. And because we record, we can share. And if you can find ways for your children to record and then share their learning, that is so powerful. Whether it's send an email to grandma and tell her about this, or write something and share it with your neighbor, or make a poster and go teach a friend what you learned. But the recording really solidifies what they learn. So as you are creating a lesson, I highly encourage you to find some way to record, for your children to record their learning. It doesn't have to be in writing. It can be verbal. Because even just teaching someone else, as you well know, when you teach someone else, it solidifies it in your heart. So find some way for them to record what they've learned. This one is just helpful for me because I have to have a list of everything I need before I start so that I can get everything together, because it's really disruptive in the lesson. This is just kind of a housekeeping thing, but it's disruptive to have to get up and go find things while you're in the middle of your lesson. So if you take a few minutes to just write down what is everything I'm going to need and then have it before you even begin, your lesson will flow more confidently. All right, so let's talk about some of the resources that are available to us. Again, you have that scientific branches of science, the scientific topics, to give you some direction where to go. The online resources handout is in your folder too, and we're going to look at some of those in a few minutes. I'm not going to go through all of them, but just know that they're there, and you may have others that you love too that you can share with each other when we do a little networking at the end, because some of you may have some favorite ones that I would love to learn about too. I'm always looking for new online resources. Teaching now is different than when we were students. There is a vast wealth of resources available to us that didn't used to be. and take advantage of those. There are some great books still, but online there are so many resources that we can take advantage of. All right, so, and you're welcome to come look at these books at the end. The scriptures are a phenomenal resource for teaching science. So think about the creation. What does the creation show us about science? On the first day, he organized matter. Wow, what a great lesson that matter always existed. Heavenly Father didn't create it. Heavenly Father gathered matter with the Savior, and they organized it. Great, great physics lesson. He separated the land from the water, so we've got a great beginning for talking about meteorology. Yes?
We were teaching that actually this last week.
Oh, good.
Yeah, we started science, and I love how, because I guess I like that, but how Heavenly Father used science to create the world.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, everything around us is science.
It is. And as you go through the creation, every day is another branch of science. And what a fun way to introduce science to your children is starting with the creation. The words of the prophets have some wonderful, wonderful science applications. And at the end of the slideshow, I just picked a few general conference talks where science stories were shared. President Uchtdorf has shared some excellent ones. And Elder Ballard, you probably have thought of some. And as you watch General Conference or listen to General Conference, you will probably hear it differently now because you're going to be listening for those little stories that you can use in your science lessons. There is always at least one each General Conference. All right, songs. I love using music in teaching science because there are so many applications. So let's think of any song you can think of that has sun or light in it. Just shout them out. The sun will rise. Mm-hmm. You are my sunshine. Oh, Mr. Sun, Sun, Mr. Cold as I am. There's so many songs, and songs are just a fun way to pull children together. So use music. It doesn't have to be church music. It can be, but there are a lot of other good songs too, just to bring in some topics for science. In our area here, and I don't know where everyone is from, but there are a lot of wonderful field trip resources available. What are some of your favorite places to take your children?
Thanksgiving Farm.
Yes. Boy, lots of resources there with the gardens, with the Dinosaur Museum, Curiosity Museum. Have you been to the Bean Museum? Awesome. Wheeler Farm and, yeah, Sandy area is great. Anybody else taking your children somewhere? Yes, planetarium is good, and that Discovery Museum up in Salt Lake's good too. Oh yeah, the University of Utah. Their Natural History Museum is phenomenal. Hogle Zoo is a good one. Oh, I haven't been there. Red Butte Gardens. Okay.
We used to do that as field trips, but they've got those too, and I think you don't necessarily have to be a classroom, but they'll do specific ones, and a lot of times a lot of places you can look up ahead of time and they'll give you a little guide, and so you can do that on your own with your kids
and just walk through it yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Excellent. Tracy Aviary is good. They'll have a guide like that too. Oh, thank you for sharing that. All right. Yes?
I'm actually from Arizona, and the Phoenix Zoo annually does things for homeschool groups where you go down and they set up a big, huge tent and they serve dinner and you stay the night and they take you to the zoo to see the nocturnal animals. And then the next morning they serve you breakfast and they take you through the zoo to see the animals getting fed for the morning. So our homeschool groups doing that.
Oh, fun.
And I don't know if the zoos up here have anything like that because it's only once a year that they do it.
Right.
But it's kind of an addition to the story.
Right. I don't know if any of you are familiar with the museum in Lehigh. It's called the Hutchings Museum. Phenomenal resource. They have the best mineral and rock collection I have seen, and lots of Utah history, and they have a gentleman there that knows everything about dinosaurs. He's been out on digs, and they have a dinosaur room, but that's a great place. Do any of you know beekeepers? Somebody who has beehives? Great. Another super resource. There are a lot of people in the community who have a science background that would probably be happy to come talk to you or have you go to their workplace. Yes?
In relation to what she said, the State Fair, I took my son there last year. We had a thing set up with a beehive. We had people there, and we had a butterfly exhibit, which shows the process of the community and everything. They have also their homeschool days and stuff. You can get cheaper, going early. And there was a school telling them there.
Thank you for sharing that. State Fair. I hadn't thought about that. Yes.
The Utah State for the National Food Museum.
Mm-hmm.
I just recently found out they do Utah State of the Teaching Trunk. If they do one, they don't call it the Teaching Trunk. It's the same idea. You can get it on loan from them and have all the materials. Do like fossils, just all the different categories.
So they will let homeschoolers just go and take a kit, check out a kit. Wonderful. Great. Your public library might be a good source, too, for some other things. Did you have a thought, too? Thank you.
I'm at my office, so I have a different set of things. But one thing in Salt Lake, next month, there's the electricity show, Dr. Bloom. And I know they have a few extra things for that. But if you go to the university, you have several things throughout the year that they have shows, summer science related.
Okay. Oh, in the bird refuge, okay. Thank you. So Ogden has a lot of resources. How do you find out about those resources?
I've Googled like homeschool field trips or best field trips in the area because I taught up here, but we live in Davis County, and so I feel like I know all the stuff up here but not down there. And I found a lot of websites that list, like, this is free or this is great. So,
excellent.
Things I didn't know about.
We love the internet. Yes?
Facebook groups are a good resource. I live up by Brigham City, but I'm in Facebook groups for the state, so I care about Facebook all over.
Excellent. And perhaps I'll pass on to the Latter-day Learning Facebook group that maybe we need to start just a field trip section there. You had another.
I was going to say Facebook too, and I'm not a big Facebook person. I don't like everyone to know my business, but I love the groups.
Mm-hmm.
Follow those and get all that information.
Good. Thank you for sharing.
Sometimes, too, when you go to these places, like I've noticed, we go to the zoo, and they'll advertise other similar venues in their flyers. So we'll get the flyers out, and it's always my children that notice that, not me. They're always like, Mom, did you see this cool thing we can go do? And I'm like,
One more.
A lot of times they'll insert, and so like they tend to help each other, and I've actually called the zoo before and said, hey, we want to look at this. We're going to California. Can you recommend, you know, because they're all connected. The zoos and stuff are
right,
connected.
So museums.
Like, well, my kids really want to see this animal. Can you tell us, do you know of a zoo in the area, this area? That, and they were able to help me find a zoo that they had that was really, really cool. So anyway.
Wonderful.
So they're helpful, too, when you just call and ask.
Good. And aren't those the things that our children remember? Those are the things I remember. I still remember as a second grader getting on the train from BYU Lab School, and we, well, the train didn't start there, but I was in BYU Lab School. We took the train, and we stopped at a bread factory, the Wonder Bread Factory, and we took the train on up into Salt Lake. Anyway, we remember those things. Those events are, they just stay in our minds. So try to include some field trip possibilities or guest speakers that come and visit your family and talk about their things. Many beekeepers are happy to do that. One other handout that you have is called Skills for Scientific Minds. And this handout is just to give you some ideas of some skills that you want to incorporate as you teach your lessons on science. We want our children and ourselves to become very good at observing, at communicating, at comparing and ordering and categorizing, relating, inferring, and applying. These are all skills that will help them to understand science and to communicate about science in a more efficient way. All right, next, talk with other homeschool families. Just as you have shared right here about field trips, many people have resources that they have found and are willing to share. They maybe have found a kit that is phenomenal, or a website, or a book. Talk to each other. How many of you are in a co-op with your homeschooling? Okay, a couple of you are. How many of you are just doing it all by yourself? A lot of you are. So how can you get connected with other homeschoolers to just say, what are you doing? What are you, how do you teach about human anatomy and physiology? Good question. Co-ops often share the teaching.
So mom teaches a group of everybody's kids.
So
in network, we do field trips together. We do our outside of home activities together. And then we do our own teaching.
Okay. Great. So use each other's resources, too. There are so many people who have invented things that we don't need to reinvent it. And I know a lot of homeschool parents, as they get started, try to replicate the public school system because that's all they know. That's what our experiences have been. And you will drive yourself crazy if you do that because you cannot replicate five children's curriculum and try to meet everybody's needs. So find out what other people are doing.
Well, I was going to say in response to your question, because one of the things I miss most about being a teacher is other teachers to say, how did you teach this? And those Facebook groups have been essential for me to be able to type in when we run in from everything to, I don't know what to do for my kid who won't hold pencil the right way, to my child wants to do math games and I don't know any math games. Does anybody know any? And so many people are so helpful at providing those things. So even though we're homeschooling on our own and I don't know a lot of people around me, I still have a community that can help with what I do.
You do. Facebook has made that very accessible. Thank you for sharing that. So I want to share with you now a few different websites that I have found really useful and some other resources online. I'm going to have to walk away from here because I have to actually touch the laptop or the computer over there. They didn't have a laptop in here. But I hope you can still hear me okay. So Science Kids comes out of New Zealand. And it's a website that is just full of a variety of projects and activities and games. You can do experiments, you can go through all these things, and it has also other curricular, not just science, projects, science fair ideas, and this is on your sheet of resources, so you don't need to write these down. It's on your resource sheet already. All right. So, when I started teaching science, one of the things that was challenging for me is I walked into this room and there was a snake and there were hamsters and there was a frog. There were many animals and I am not a pet person. So this was a really big challenge for me to overcome, and I'm learning. I can be nice to them, but I don't love them. But the children do, and so that's why I have kept them there. Though I do love the snake, I have to admit. I've learned to love the snake. And if you need a pet, snakes are the best. You clean their cage twice a year. You feed them about once every 3 weeks, and that's it. They are so easy. So, and kids love them. So snakes are a really good one, and you can get lockdown lids so you don't have to worry about them escaping. But in science, not while I was teaching. Okay. That was the teacher before me. So, but I do worms with my kindergartners, and I do a lot of hands-on things, but I don't do dissections because I can't. My reflex just goes, wah, and I don't want to throw up in front of children. So there's a really great website that does some virtual dissections. So we're going to dissect a salmon here, and you'll see how fun this is, and children love it. You just grab the tweezers. It tells you what to do. Oh, let's grab the fins and flip them, and let's take his eyeball out and put it up in the tray. And so you have to do all the little things it says to do. I think you can even move his mouth. All right. Then you get to put those back and get the scalpel and you cut him up. Do you want to do the whole thing? It's kind of fun. Oh, it's not giving me the next button yet. There we go. So now we get to take the scalpel, and the children love this. They just go, ooh, yuck. But you get to open up the fish, put the scalpel back, put the scalpel back. Some of them, sometimes they're not as responsive. Then you get to pick up the spoon and scoop out all the eggs. But isn't this better than doing it in real life? Okay. So you get the idea. They have a couple of different dissections that you can do, and they get to just play with stuff without getting messy. It's great, and it doesn't smell up your house. So virtual dissections are great. Grant Thompson is actually a local person who has started his own YouTube channel. He has so many fascinating demonstrations on his website. I want to show you one. And by the way, if you're not familiar with tube chop, if you find something on YouTube that you really want, but you only want to use a piece of it, you go to tubechop.com and you put in the YouTube video, and then you can just chop out the section you want. So it's a really great one. So watch how he makes this.
With this one simple trick, you'll be able to take any bottle of soda and pour out an instant slushy on command. Now, if you don't believe what you're seeing, that's okay, but it is real. And in this project, you'll discover the insanely easy secret to making an instant soda slushy.
So he has lots and lots of demonstrations, and he goes step by step how to do it. My 10-year-old grandchildren love this website and love to go on and try out his experiments. And it's usually all stuff you have around the house. Yes? It is King of Random under YouTube. All right. Now, another personal favorite of mine is a group of guys who love science and love music, and they have made some phenomenal YouTube videos for science.
The Bloodmobile, the Bloodmobile, a delivery service inside.
Delivered by the Bloodmobile. heart or regulate your hunger or your sleep. The hormones are the message. They're sent from many glands. The messenger's the plug. Somebody's got to haul out the trash to the liver and the kidneys. It's not a pretty job. Carbon dioxide gets carried to the lungs to be exhaled. And the garbage truck is the blood mobile.
The blood mobile, the blood mobile. A delivery service inside us to carry oxygen, nutrients, things that fight infection. Trash collection and delivery in there.
And we're all delivered by the blood.
Isn't that fun? They do so many great science videos, and the children say, I want to see it again, and they'll be singing it forever, and it is such a powerful tool for getting understanding about science concepts into their hearts and minds. All right. So I started talking about how the words of the prophets can give us great information for our science lessons as well. Elder Richard G. Scott in this conference talk said, how captivating to watch a seed planted in fertile soil germinate, gather strength, and send forth a tiny, seemingly insignificant sprout. Patiently it begins to grow and develop its own character, led by the genetic code the Lord has provided to guide its development. With care it surely will become what it is destined to be, a lily crowned with grace and beauty, a fragrant spearmint plant, a peach, an avocado, or a beautiful blossom with unique delicacy, hue, and fragrance. When last did you observe a tiny rosebud? And he goes on, just one of many. Elder Ballard has done several good ones. I don't know if you remember the one where he talked about bees. Anybody remember that one? In this one, he said, my beloved brothers and sisters, each time I enjoy a fresh vine-ripened tomato or eat a juicy peach right off the tree, my thoughts go back 60 years to when my father owned a small peach orchard in Holiday. He kept beehives there to pollinate the peach blossoms that would eventually grow into very large, delicious peaches. Father loved his gentle honeybees, and he goes through and he talks about the work that honeybees do and how they spend their whole life to just create like an eighth of a teaspoon of honey, and how it takes all of them to work together. And so as you're talking about pollination, what a wonderful resource to add to your lesson and to talk about a gospel principle of how we need to work together and help each other to accomplish a common goal as families. He gave another talk where he talked, oh, whoops, let me do this one first. Sorry, I got to come back over here again. Oh, my link is gone. There it is. Nope. Okay. President Uchtdorf gave a talk about light. And in this, you might want to write that talk down, because if you go to LDS.org, there is a video clip in there that is powerful, and I thought I had it linked. I apologize, it didn't work. But the link shows how, because we have more light now because of the Hubble telescope, we can see further into space and can learn so much more because of having more light. More visible light makes us able to see more. And it's just a beautiful discussion about the power of light helping us to see and understand. And what a great gospel principle can follow from that as we talk about the importance of the light of Christ and how that light of Christ enlightens our minds and allows us to see truth more clearly. Neil Anderson, you might have remembered his talk. Many years ago, while we were visiting our family in Florida, a tornado touched down not too far from us. One woman living in a mobile home went to her bathroom for safety. The mobile home began to shake. A few moments passed. Then she heard her neighbor's voice. I'm here in the front room. Coming out of the bathroom, to her great astonishment, she discovered that the tornado had lifted and carried her mobile home through the air, landing it perfectly upright on the top of her neighbor's mobile home. He goes on to talk about storms in life And what a great story to share as you're teaching your children about tornadoes and hurricanes and the storms in physical life, and then to pull in a gospel principle about the storms that we experience in our lives. There are many. Elder Ballard, I forgot to share you the other story, was the one about his granddaughter who thought she had killed her tomato plant that they started in school, and the process of helping a plant to grow. There are many inspired stories from the brethren and sisters who speak in general conference, and I just encourage you to really listen to those differently as you listen to conference, this next conference. I love our Heavenly Father's creations and the way that they are so powerful at displaying His glory and His magnificence. As we sing, I am having a brain freeze, "How Great Thou Art." What a wonderful song to just praise God in His creations. I wanted to leave some time here at the end just for questions and answers, and then I had one other thing to share with you. So maybe let me share this one last thing, and then we'll do some questions and answers. Oop, there's my binder. I just wanted to share with you what children can reason and relate on their own. In teaching about insect life cycles, we talked about the metamorphosis that many insects go through. Some have a complete metamorphosis of 4 stages, some have an incomplete, and it's 3 stages. But as we talked about this with third graders, we also talked about Alma the Younger and his metamorphosis. We read his story and talked about him. And then I asked the children to draw a life cycle of a butterfly from egg to adult, and then to write, how was Alma the Younger's experience kind of similar to a metamorphosis? So this came from an 8-year-old. Alma was a young wicked man. He had some friends. They were all members of the church, also Alma, but they didn't believe. They murdered people and set houses on fire. I'm not quite sure where she got that, but that's okay. I'm only responsible for what I teach them. What they get taught at home is... One day, Alma and his friends went to the forest. After a few minutes, an angel appeared. The light was so bright that he passed out. Alma stayed in bed for 3 days. This story reminds me of a caterpillar, as if it started as an egg, then larva, pupa, and last an adult butterfly. Alma changed his heart, just like a caterpillar turning into a butterfly. And we can, too. Well, that's pretty insightful. Alma the Younger experienced metamorphosis. Alma fainted, but some insects go in a chrysalis. So he's making this correlation. And then he changed, like some insects in their chrysalis change into a butterfly. Alma changed because he repented. Insects change like a butterfly changes because they used to be a caterpillar and they're supposed to be a butterfly. So isn't that great what our children can reason and correlate between God's wonderful use of science and gospel principles? And I can't express enough how important it is to make that correlation in your teachings. Whatever it is you are teaching in science, I promise that you can probably come up with a gospel principle. So what questions or other things would you like to share for the last 5 minutes or so? Does anybody have any questions? Or
The websites that you were talking about, mm-hmm. Khan Academy is really
yes.
Math. It
is, Khan Academy. If you haven't looked at that one, do they have things? I've looked at for a couple of topics, but they were very high level. Do they have anything for younger?
They're high level, but my daughter in second grade loves them.
Good.
So they explain it to her. She loves anatomy. Mm. And so she learned all about the love dove. She just watches the videos. She doesn't like the quizzes, so she doesn't do that. The quizzes are a little hard for her, but she loves to just watch the videos.
Great.
She loves what she
learns. Wonderful.
So, along that same line, my 8-year-old son has been, so when we learned something, we just learned about the water cycle. So I looked up a YouTube video with music. And there's a fun little YouTube song about the water cycle. So he was listening to it, and I babysit my 3-year-old grandson. And the next day, the mom brought him back, my dog one bought my grandson back, and she goes, thank you for teaching him about the water cycle.
By osmosis.
The song, she said, he's sitting in the bathtub playing with the water and singing the water cycle song.
Isn't that great?
I had a water bottle sitting with me in the car on the way out, and he goes, look, there's precipitation in your water bottle. Or condensation, what was it? Condensation.
Is it the banana guys?
It could be. They were, anyways, it was so the music, and that they're picking up, like she's saying, your two-year-old, mm-hmm. It's amazing what they'll pick up if you just have it in your home in a fun way that they can learn at their will.
And if you do that, if you go to YouTube and you just search a science topic, you will get all kinds of possibilities to use. Great.
I found when I was killing time in the Apple stores, my husband was loving the tech, they've got a cool app, the human body, and I think they have a free one, but I liked it well enough, I bought it. But it's got all the different systems you can, and so I have that on my phone, and that's one of my kids' favorite things to play with when we're, like, playing with the doctor's office or whatever. And so I've got my three-year-old who will dissect the skeleton and put it back together, and she just loves it, but it's really cool.
Thank you. So that's an Apple app called what?
Human Body. And they've got a few others, too. They've got one on plants. It's the same group that does it.
Okay, so
I've got one on home systems too. Those are okay. They're not my favorite, but the human body one is phenomenal. The free one gives you a couple of the human body systems, and then when you purchase it, it gives you, I mean, it's got the digestive, it's got circulatory, it's, and so
great.
We used it too when we were talking about what happens to your body when you're running, and because it'll have them run and it'll show the heartbeat speeding up or the lungs.
Wonderful. So the Apple app Human Body Systems. Wonderful. I didn't even go into apps. Does anybody else have some favorite apps you want to share? All right. But that is another place to look. There's some really good stargazing apps. So I look for those too. Yes?
Really quick along that line, Rock and Learn, they have a great phonics-based system, but I got their science set. They are excellent. It's all done on cartoon stuff, but again, my younger kids picked up on things that now I can go more in depth with them, but they go through all the body systems and explain them each. So,
and they're Rock and
Learn.
Rock, letter N, Learn.
And yeah, their phonics system is great too if you're teaching reading or anything like that. They have an awesome week.
Thank you for sharing that. Yes.
Stage 1 and Stage 2 are books.
Oh, excellent. Do you know who the publisher is on that? Or, oh, it's different authors, but is it like a Scholastic? Rainbow Resources. Look for the Stage 1 and Stage 2 science books.
That's just the title of the book. And they all have, let's see, like, there's one thing talking about bees. They have one that's called Honey to Hive, for example. So they all have their own titles, but they're all, like, the Stage 2 book.
So it's a set of some sort.
Yeah, so it's, like, they have several sets, maybe, like, 4 or 5 sets. If you get them all, there's, like, over 100.
Wow. Excellent. Any others? I appreciate your sharing because I'm always looking for new resources too. Yes?
This is a great, well, it's a resource, living person resource, but there's a man in our community that does wild edibles tours. And so he'll come teach groups of students and take them into fields, or you can, like, twice or three times a year, he goes up in the mountains and teaches them how to identify wild berries or things growing up out of the ground. We live on acreage, so he comes out every spring and we gather our friends and neighbors, and he shows us, like, what the sago lily looks like as it's coming up, and they've kind of come back a few times to show the kids, like, what you could actually eat if you had to survive off of the land, the desert landscape. And it's amazing, like, what these people that have studied this stuff really know about plants, and he shows them how to dig up specific bulbs, like, what bulbs to eat and what bulbs you can't, and that kind of a thing, but it's fun. Like, my kids really enjoy it, and so we finished a couple of those tours with him, and he His name's Mike Wood, and it's utahwildedibles.com, I think is his website. But it's really fun. He's not very expensive, but he comes out and teaches them all about, you know, that there were kids that when the kids came across the plains, they didn't bring food with them. And they had to know how to, you know, how to eat what they could get their hands on. And so my kids have really enjoyed, oh, Mom, look, there's a sago lily coming up, and you can't eat that because that's the state flower. And, you know, they, like, went through and were showing me all these things and how to cut open some of our the succulents and get the food out of the middle of a succulent, how to do it without stabbing yourself. And he showed them all kinds of cool things.
Wow.
And anyway, my kids had a really, really good time, and we enjoy spending time with him. So
Thank you.
A new and different way to do science, because he talks about how even some of the poisonous plants affect your body system and what they do and why it's important to know the difference. And
oh, fabulous. And that's another area that we didn't explore when we were talking about our field trips. Hikes, there are just endless opportunities for hiking here. And one of the most exciting things for children is to be able to name things. There is power in being able to name things. So even just learning to identify plants, flowers, trees, gives them a sense of excitement that I know what that tree is. And it's powerful to do that for children.
Off of that, there's an app called PlantNet.
PlantNet app, okay.
It's like Shazam for music, where you can, you know, listen to the song. But this one, supposedly, I haven't experimented much, but you can go up to a plant and do the picture, and it'll tell you what it is. So I thought that would be helpful, because I don't know anything, but I think the kids would like
that. That is good. There's a plant one, there's a leaf one, and there's a bird one. And I don't know if they're all the same company, but yes, you can just take a photograph and it will identify it. And I don't have my phone with me.
It's called PlantNet.
PlantNet. So there's some good apps for identification there. Thank you for sharing your resources. There are so many things out there to make teaching science fun and less intimidating. I hope that you walk away today feeling energized that this is not hard, I can do this, and that you will see the wonder of Heavenly Father's creation in everything that you do now. It's exciting. It's exciting what our Heavenly Father has done for us and how he teaches us about orderliness, about consistency, about dependability through science. The reason scientists can do science is because science is predictable. Nature doesn't play tricks on us. And what a great lesson for our children to learn about our Heavenly Father and how dependable he is, and that he is not up there trying to trick us in any way, but he wants us to learn and to come to know him. Thank you for being here today. I appreciate your attendance.